welcome to Bookery 2. Wonderful to have you all here on a gorgeous Sunday afternoon. Before I introduce Bryna, not that she needs an introduction to possibly anybody here, I just want to let you all know that we have quite a few events coming up, and there are posters around the store like this, and I'll be sending, if you're on my mailing list, I'll send you notices, and also we have a newsletter which will be out in a couple of days, which have all the events. And other than that, I don't really think I need to introduce Bryna, who's written a number of books, is one of our dear friends and a great Ithacan. And I just, let's all welcome Bryna Fireside.
Well, thank you. Thank you. That was a nice introduction. I brought a Seder plate in case there should be one person in here who may not know what a Seder plate looks like, because it figures in the story. This one came from Israel. I think my father was there with a couple of my nieces. Yeah, I think so. And I think that's what one of the things that he got me. Can you all hear me? Yeah? Okay. Well, about, 8 or 9 or maybe even 10 years ago, I came across, I like to play around on the computer. I'm really mostly computer illiterate. And I came across this really interesting article in a newspaper called The Jewish Messenger, which I believe came out of New York, but there may have been other venues for it, like in Ohio and other places where there were fairly large numbers of Jews. It was written in 1866, this particular article, and it was by the title character in my book called Private Joel. And he wrote about his joining the Union Army in 1861 with a bunch of other guys from Cincinnati. And there were 21, including him, 21 Jewish fellows in the 23rd Regiment from Ohio. And they were sitting around in the wilds of West Virginia, not, as the journal wrote it, small West Virginia, but the West Virginia. And it was getting on into April, and they knew that Passover was coming. And I read this article and I thought, gee, this will make a really fun children's book, because it was all about how they got to be able to do this and what they could get, because I don't think there were too many Jews in Fayette, West Virginia at the time, so they had to improvise a lot. And it was a very amusing article, but you know, I wanted to write it for kids, and sometimes it takes a while, like years, before the story gels. I'll fast forward to 4 years ago, maybe it was three or four years ago. The 92nd Street Y, somehow I got on their mailing list, for which I am ever grateful, and it had the full list of all the events going on at the Y in New York. And among them, I read, was a conference of Jewish writers who were writing about Jewish themes for kids. Not necessarily Jewish kids, but aimed at a particular target audience. And I looked at that and I thought about Private Joel and the fact that I never finished this thing. But they said I could send one page. So I pulled out one page, the first page, which seemed to look okay to me. I made a couple of changes in it and I sent it down. And I went to this conference and it has really changed my life, because there are, if anyone is interested or is writing for Jewish kids, this conference is held in November of every year at the Y. I think this was the second or third conference they had. There were only 100 people, conference goers, and there were 10 editors. 10 editors, and they were all looking for Jewish material. And they read some of the first pages, and they had a panel that discussed them. They didn't read mine, but anyway, he had a chance to talk to people. They had breakfast, they had lunch, you know, it was a Jewish event, so they had a lot of food. And it was fun. And I came back home, and I was just, you know, you always get something out of a conference, and I was just really fired up. 2 days after I got back, I had an email from one of the editors that said, send me the rest of the manuscript. And I said, oh, I better finish it. So I gave myself a deadline, and I said, it'll be down in 2 weeks. And it was. I sent it down in 2 weeks. Now, it was about 3,500 words. And 2 months later, I had a contract. This has never in the history of my writing has ever happened that in 2 months after I send something down that I get a real live contract and an advance in my hands. It's Carr Ben Publishing Company. They treated me very well. I never did see, first they wanted me to cut 1,000 words. 1,000 words, holy smokes. So I started cutting, and thank goodness one of my sons is an editor, and he came down to visit, and I said, here, I have to get the rest of the words out. And it's always good to have another eye look at it, and so he took out some words, and I took out some words. Anyway, I got it down pretty close. And then I didn't hear from them. In fact, I didn't hear from them until the book was published, which is kind of a stretch. Anyway, Private Joel and the Sewell Mountain Seder, I got my copies of it about 3 weeks before Harvey died. And so he was able to see it and was thrilled with it, as I was. And then it came out officially in a month later. One of the things that I love about the book is I love the illustrations. I feel that I really lucked out. The illustrations are very special. They're not drawings, they're paintings. And I was able to call the illustrator. She lives down in, and it's a she, Sean Costello. Don't think she's Jewish, but she does know how to paint. And I talked to her, I told her I was thrilled with what she had done with the book. And I think if you take a look at it, you will agree with me. I hope that Gary has passed out these papers, has he? No? Hiding them. Well, somewhere he's got these papers with the original story, Passover, A Reminiscence of the War by J.A. Joel. And so you can read it and keep it. Keep your own copy of it. Oh, there was one thing I didn't know. Like, when was Passover in 1862? Now, it happens. The computer is a wonderful thing. There's, I bet most of you don't know this, there is something called Ask Moses. Human questions, heavenly answers. And he calls it moseying along. So there's a little space where you can ask a question. So I asked a question. When was Passover in 1862? And I got an answer back. Not only did I get an answer back, I get Ask Moses at least once or twice a month. And this one was, Moses doesn't really answer, though. You can ask them, but he passes the question on to someone who's earthbound. So this question was answered by Rabbi Shlomo Chen, and it's a back and forth thing, and he says, hi, Matt, good afternoon, and he says, hi, Mo, and his question of the week was, I wanted to talk to you about a kippah and Shabbos. Editor's note, he means Shabbat. he doesn't use Yiddish anymore. He says, you know, I want to wear a yarmulke, but I don't observe the Sabbath. So am I wrong to wear the yarmulke? This is a really heartrending question. And you too can log on to askmoses.com and find the answer. And also, I wanted to find out if there were, what the names of some of the other Jewish soldiers were in the 23rd Regiment from the Buckeye State. So I, you know, what do? You type in Jewish soldiers, 23rd Regiment, Civil War. And you get this list of Jewish soldiers, but they didn't keep really good records, so there were only five. There was Private Joel, and four of what I assumed are his buddies. And so they are the real people, and also the commander is a real person. The others I made up. I made up, and I used the word Negro in the book because that's what they were known as. African Americans, blacks were known as Negroes, and so that's what I used in the book. There were 180,000 African Americans who fought on the Union side during the Civil War. I got that from typing in Negro soldiers, Negro Union soldiers, Civil War. Comes up with more information. And I found out that there were 180,000. Now, there were some all Negro troops that were commanded by white officers, but there had to be others who fled and latched on to whatever Union Army they could find. So I just want to read a little bit, give you a taste of, I can show and tell, I can show pictures too, but you can look for yourself later. I'll start with chapter 2. When the word of the Passover Seder got around, three Negro soldiers approached JJ. They were former slaves who had joined the 23rd Regiment. "Private Joel," said Caleb Berger, "me and my buddies know something about your Hebrew Passover." "How's that?" said JJ. "Well, when I was a young boy, I was sold to Master Berger, and he was a Hebrew, and his family celebrated Passover. I worked in the main house, and I learned all the prayers. In fact, Master Berger taught me to read some English and Hebrew. And back in 59, when I was 16, he let me earn my freedom." "Then how did you become a slave again?" asked JJ. "Well, I got caught up in a roundup one night, and it didn't matter that I was a free man. I got sold to one of the meanest masters ever to walk this earth. That's where I met up with Abraham and Samuel. And soon after I was captured, I learned about the war to free us. But we didn't want to wait, so we planned our escape, and we found the 23rd Regiment." And here she's got them escaping. If you want to come up closer and look, you can. "And we would love to celebrate the holy day of freedom with you," said Caleb. "Well, would you help us prepare for the Seder?" "Yes, sirree," Caleb said, "and Abraham and Samuel will help too. Passover is for free men, and today we are free men." JJ looked around at the three proud Negro soldiers. He felt a bond so powerful that it made him dizzy. "It would be an honor to have your help," he said, "and to have you at our table." The Jewish soldiers and the three Negro recruits met to figure out what they needed. JJ took charge. "First, we'll have to find a way to get the matzah," he told them. "We'll have to pool our money and pay for it." "Well, that's easy," said Solly. "The paymaster was here just 3 days ago, and there's not too much to spend our greenbacks on in the wilderness," and all the guys chuckled. "Just a minute, gentlemen," said a voice from outside the tent. "I, Greenberg, can help you." Mr. Greenberg was not a soldier. He was a sutler, a man who traveled with the troops and sold them supplies such as shaving soap, razors, writing paper, stamps, and pens. And Mr. Greenberg was Jewish. And, in fact, Mr. Greenberg, who they called Greenie, said, "I'm leaving for Cincinnati first thing tomorrow morning, and I will buy your matzah and send it back to you on the next supply train." So the soldiers each chipped in some dollars to give it to Mr. Greenberg. "Don't worry," he said, "I won't disappoint. Greenie always keeps his word." And right away the guys were a little worried. Would he come back with the money? Well, sure enough, in the wee hours of the morning of April 14th, the familiar clickety-clack got louder as the supply train grew closer to the village of Fayette. It ground to a stop with a loud screech and a puff of smoke, and a cheer went up as the soldiers began to unload the supplies. "Look," shouted Solly, "7 barrels of matzah, enough for the entire week of Passover." "And there's more," exclaimed JJ. "Greeny sent 2 Haggadahs and some prayer books." So they really lucked out. Only now, they've got to rush off and get the rest of the stuff. Old Rosie, who was the nickname of the commander, Rosencrantz, they never called him that to his face, gave the Jewish soldiers leave to get ready. Caleb, Abraham, and Samuel were given time off as well. None of them had ever prepared for a Seder. It was the job that had been left to their mothers, wives, and sisters. But Caleb had helped his mama get ready for the burger Seder. "I'll be glad to help cook," he said. JJ made a list of what needed to be done. "We don't have much time," he told them. 7 men were assigned to build a log hut, a place to hold the Seder. Abraham and Samuel volunteered to help. 4 others hitched up some horses to a wagon and rode off to the local farmers with a list of provisions for the traditional Passover meal of, what else, chicken soup and roasted lamb. They also needed wine and foods that go on the Seder plate. An egg, parsley, haroset, and bitter herbs. In the meantime, Caleb started cooking fires and began heating large pots of water for the soup. He gathered metal rods, dug a huge pit, and built a spit for the roast. By mid-morning, the soldiers returned with a lamb, 7 chickens, dozens of eggs, bunches of carrots with green, feathery tops. "We couldn't find any parsley," said Isaac. "Or horseradish," said George. But one farmer dug up something he said would be really bitter enough. He held up some long, skinny, green and red weeds that no one had ever seen before. Caleb washed away the dirt and chopped them up. "Say," Bill asked, "does anyone know what part of the lamb goes on a Seder plate?" No one knew. "Well, if we roast the whole thing, put the whole thing on the table, we're sure to get the right part," Solly suggested. And after much discussion, everyone agreed. So while Solly helped Caleb put the lamb on the spit, a couple of soldiers chopped up the vegetables. And Caleb set to cleaning the chickens for the soup. Meanwhile, the others were putting the finishing touches on the hut. JJ directed the soldiers to set the table for 26 men. 21 for the Jewish soldiers, 3 for the Negro soldiers, and 1 for Commander Rosencrantz. But what's the extra setting for? I really have to count on my fingers for this. "In our family, we always set an extra plate for the strangers," said JJ. In the distance, JJ saw George pushing a barrel up the hill. "You found wine." "No, not wine," said George, "it's cider. It's been sitting around all winter, and it should be just ripe by now." So, I'm going to, I'll read you one more page. "Hey," Isaac called Solly, "the water's beginning to boil. We'd better get started with the matzo balls." Isaac took some sheets of matzo and put them in a bowl and beat them into fine crumbs with a hammer. "Well, this looks like enough," he said when the bowl was full. "Well, now what?" said Solly. "Well, I think you put some eggs and some water," Isaac offered. So Solly cracked a dozen eggs into the bowl, and Isaac stirred it all up, and they dipped their hands in cold water so the matzo mixture wouldn't stick. Sally scooped up some batter and rolled it around in his hands. Okay, he asked Isaac, showing him a rather lopsided ball. It's got to be more round, said Isaac. My mother's were always round. He took another handful of batter and rolled it around and around till it was nice and smooth. Pack it hard like a snowball, said. I'll tell you where I got that idea in a minute. JJ came to the cooking area. I need the stuff for the Seder plate. Ain't got no parsley, said Caleb. But these carrot tops will do. They're nice and green. What are we going to use for the haroset, asked JJ. We don't have nuts and we don't have any apples. Well, said Caleb, scratching his head, that haroset stuff, isn't that supposed to represent the mortar used in the bricks? Yeah, that's exactly right. Got any ideas? Caleb reached down and picked up a brick from the fireplace. Here, will this do? Sure will. We can't eat it, but it serves the purpose. Let's see, we've turned cider into wine. We've turned carrot tops into parsley. We've turned this wheat into horseradish. And now we've turned a brick into a brick. Well, even if we don't get things exactly right, I'm sure the good Lord will accept our efforts. You know, fellas, this is going to be the best Passover ever. And I'll stop there. And the matzo balls. The first year we started the Ithaca Reformed Temple, we decided to have a community Passover in the restaurant that used to be Cabbage Town and was then currently owned by, I just lost his name, he makes falafel, farmers. What's his name? I just forgot it. But he's a Sephardic Jew. And he had never made a matzo ball. So, Zvi Boker. But he was anxious to learn, and so a couple of us sat him down and explained how you make a matzo ball. And they also decided the whole thing had to be vegetarian because it was a vegetarian restaurant, so we fiddled around with that. And we were served soup. It was a lovely vegetable soup, and in it was a nice, fat matzo ball that was perfectly round, like a baseball. And it was just as hard. And I carried that image around with me. You know, you wonder, where does a writer get the ideas? That was one of the ideas I carried around for years, and I said, aha, it goes in this book. And so there's a funny scene in here where they try to eat, this time, chicken soup with a matzo ball. Thank you very much. And I'll be happy to answer any questions.
What age level is
I didn't pick the age level, but they did, and they claim it's for ages 7 to 10. Mm-hmm. And it's a chapter book, and it's one that a good reader can read by him or herself. And so that's it. Anything else?
Yeah. Brenda, your publisher had all these illustrations made and you didn't see them until the book came out?
Well, I actually did see the cover. And I saw the cover and I thought, oh wow, this is really going to be good.
But no. They didn't ask for any input from you on the
I think it was, I think what happened is that one of the editors, Carr Ben is owned by Lerner Publishing Company. Carr Ben is in Maryland. And Lerner is in Minneapolis, and I think that one of the editors got sent out to Minneapolis, where she is now. And so somehow, it sort of got lost. Me, I mean, yeah.
I don't think that's unusual. I know many children's authors because I worked in the field, and they talk about how they're shocked when they get the cover. Mm-hmm. They mm-hmm. have very little wiggle room mm-hmm. with that, and it's one mm-hmm. of children's authors' biggest bones they have to pick with publishers, and it makes a big difference what's on the cover.
Mm-hmm. Yes, in fact, many years ago, my husband Harvey's PhD thesis got published by Harvard Press, and they sent him a copy of the cover, and he hated it. And he said, I don't want this cover. I will design my own cover. And he did, and they let it go. He's the only person I know that he's ever done that. And if you're very well known, and you're a famous author, as I am not, except in Ithaca, then you can pretty much pick your own illustrator, and you get a little more input into the whole thing.
I wanted to ask whether you had any other ideas for producing a book.
Yeah, I do have. I'm very interested in the Civil War, and I'm also very interested in writing about Jewish Americans who, I mean, the work has been done on coming over during the 1880s and 90s and 20s and going to Lower East Side and doing X, Y, and Z and, you know, moving uptown. And there have been absolutely wonderful, wonderful books about the Holocaust. But there are not many books about Jews during the Civil War on both sides. And I think one of the reasons I wanted to include Caleb as one of the characters with a Jewish last name is because I wanted kids to know that there were Southern Jews, many of them, and they were slave owners. And they might have been good and they might have been bad, but nevertheless, they were slave owners. And that's an important piece of history that they ought to know about. And there is one woman who is on the Confederate side. Her name is Phoebe Yates Levy, and her last name was, when she married, was Pember. And she was from a wealthy Jewish Southern family in South Carolina. And her husband died shortly before the war. He was not Jewish. There was a lot of marrying out and in. And among Southern Christians and Jews. And according to one writer, if you were wealthy and Jewish, you were accepted into the Christian society. They didn't dump on you that much until after the Civil War, when the influx of Jews from Russia and Poland were coming in, and that's when the KKK started. You know, they had their own list of people they hated. But the woman that I was particularly interested in, Phoebe, was disliked by her family. I think she was the fifth girl in a row, and you know, that pretty much soured them on her. But she was also a writer, and she was adventurous, and she took a job. Paying job, $40 a month, as the matron of the largest Confederate hospital in Virginia, right outside of Richmond. And her life there, she kept a diary, and she wrote it up as a Southern woman's journey. And I have a copy of that, and she was just an amazing woman. She was a feminist to her toes, and she battled the medical establishment. She battled, she fought for these soldiers who were brought in. You know, medication they had was pretty slim. Mostly what they gave soldiers to dull the pain was alcohol, which unfortunately the doctors often drank up more than the soldiers did. So she actually read her matron's duties, saw that she was in charge of the booze, and had a special closet made with a lock, and she locked up the booze and only gave it out to those who deserved it. And she did some other amazing things, and she's one that I am working on now. Yeah. So yes, there are just lots of stories out there, and the web is an amazing place to get started. You have to go further than that, but to get started is really great. Anything else? Thank you. And also, I wanted to thank Mr. Ellison for videotaping, and Vise for finding this perfect person. And thank you very much, and to Gary for giving me this opportunity. And if you would like to buy any books, I'll be happy to sign them.